Hello, everybody, and welcome to today's event. The event is titled SEFTA, Shaping the Region to Fit into the EU's Shoes. This is an event which is hosted by LISI, the LSE Research on Southeast Europe. My name is Vasilis Manastiotis. I'm the director of LISI and an academic at LSE. So today's lecture is about the modern SEFTA, the Central European Free Trade Agreement, which since its signing into, it covers the area of the Western Balkans and Moldova. And since it was signed in 2006, it has made amazing steps and developed a lot, the trade relations, but also more generally economic cooperation in the region. And indeed, today it is seen as a springboard for stimulating economic development locally within the region, but also stimulating the EU accession agenda, both for the Western Balkans and perhaps prospectively further afield. I will take a couple of moments to introduce our speakers. We are very, very glad to be able to be hosting today as our keynote speaker, the director of SEFTA, of the SEFTA Secretariat, Mr. Emir Djikic, who has been director of the SEFTA Secretariat since May 2017. Emir started his career in the Ministry of Foreign Trade and Economic Relations of Bosnia and Herzegovina. And since 2003, I think, he has been working and until he moved to SEFTA in the private sector, but also being engaged in non-governmental organizations, especially with Transparency International as a member of the board of directors since 2001, and then as chair of the board of directors between 2008 and 2015. Emir Djikic has a degree from the Moscow State University and a bachelor's and a master's degree in economy. With us, we also have a good colleague, Professor Silvana Moisovska, who is professor at the Institute of Economics in, of St. Cyril and Methodius University in Skopje in North Macedonia. Silvana has a wide range of interests, but specializes in the area of international economics and EU integration, and has worked for a very big number of research projects and published academic and policy work with a focus on the Western Balkans, focusing again on interregional trade on the Western Balkans and on integration. She has been actively involved in the academic policy interfacing of SEFTA with the academic community, and indeed, in a previous period, she was also one of the coordinators of the network that we have, the LISI SEFTA Academic Network. She was one of the coordinators of the network. She knows the topic very well, and I'm sure she's going to offer a very good response and discussion to the points raised by our keynote speaker. Before I pass the floor to our speakers, a couple of announcements. For those that use Twitter in the audience, the hashtag for today's event is #LSEESEFTA, so LISI, LSEESEFTA, one word. The event is being recorded, and subject to not having any technical difficulties, it will be made available as a podcast later on through the LSE website. At the end of the presentations, we will open the floor for questions and answers. There will be time for you to ask your questions. Submit your questions. Please use the Q&A feature at the bottom of your screen. Questions will be submitted to myself, and I will then pose as many questions as possible to our speakers. If you're watching the event live on Facebook, please type your questions in the comment section, and then we will pick them up from there. If possible, please state your affiliation and your name when submitting your questions to inform our speakers. So that's it for me. Without further ado, let me pass the floor to Emir Djikic, who's going to present on SEFTA and if it fits the issues. Emir, the floor is yours.
Myself. Thank you, Vasilis, very much for the invitation, and thank you for the cooperation that we had in the previous year with the LSE and with the network, and with the network for Southeast Europe. I'm glad to have this presentation, although it's coming after a long day. Let's say this morning I started my day in Moldova, where we had an opening of a pilot project on the border crossing of Leuceni and Levica in between Moldova and Romania. After that, we discussed the advancement of the CRM reforms and CRM activities with the RCC and European Commission in Sarajevo. After that, I went to Belgrade, where we were discussing the harmonization of the veterinary certificates during the day, and here I am in London in the afternoon to have this presentation. So basically it's quite a traveling day with not moving from your chair in the office. So thanks to Zoom and the other tools that we have and that the pandemic has imported to us. Today I will present you something, some kind of the small evolution of the CEFTA, which was since its establishment in 2006, and basically the main activities and the main challenges of CEFTA in today's world, as well as try to answer at the end or give my opinion on the shoes that you are wearing at the moment, and basically try to pass with you through the issues that we are dealing with. As well, I wish to say at the beginning that I will not go too much into the details, or I will try not to go too much into the details. So basically, if you are interested in details in some of the areas, please ask a question, or you can contact us in the secretariat all the times to get detailed answers on the detailed questions, because if you stay on the, we can stay, I stayed 2 days, last 2 days I was on the veterinary certificates, hopping in and off on one veterinary certificate. So basically we can spend a lot of time on that, and but I want to have the opportunity that the wider opinion is listening. So the details, please, to questions to Vasilis, and we will try to answer. I have prepared a small presentation to guide us, and if I am able to share it and knowledgeable enough to share it, I would share it to ease the following to all of us. Let me see now. I hope that you see the presentation now.
Yes, I'm here. Yeah.
So basically, when we were discussing the title, the title itself is something where we are finding ourselves, and where the Western Balkans and Moldova are finding ourselves at this moment, and basically different ideas and different initiatives are launched, where to show which are going into the different directions. But let me start, and let me return back a little bit into the history. So basically, CEFTA 2006, as we call it, was signed in Bucharest on 19th of December 2006. And it is based on the Visegrad CEFTA, because it was decided that we will take over the Visegrad CEFTA and basically join the Visegrad CEFTA. I'm referring to CEFTA of the four Visegrad countries that was signed in 1992. And was lasting after replaced with CEFTA 2006. And that's why we are called Central and East European FTA, although the parties are the Western Balkans. And basically this agreement in 2006 has replaced 32 bilateral free trade agreements that the parties had before that, simplifying the trade and making it more transparent. In the first period, the task was to fully liberalize the trade in goods, both in industrial and non-industrial goods. And we managed to fulfill this with industrial goods in 2010, and with agricultural products, the last were liberalized in 2015. With the liberalization of trade and making it fully liberalized within the region, the diagonal accumulation was introduced in the framework of the CEFTA agreement. The opening of the public procurement markets, non-discrimination within CEFTA, public procurement markets to CEFTA parties was introduced. The state aid notifications and the state aid reports are provided by the parties in order to see and assess the possibilities and the existence of the trade distortive state aids. The intellectual property rights review, the participation of the parties in the different intellectual property rights conventions was assessed as well. And we had tools and provisions on the non-discrimination in investments. As well with this, we developed some of the transparency tools where we had developed the system of the notifications through the CEFTA transparency pack that is available on the website, that was available on the website at the time and is now undergoing the reform. So basically we had all the informations about the SPS measures. TBT platform has notified the TBT measures of the parties, and the CEFTA market access database was used internally for the cases between the parties in order that the parties can resolve the cases that they had on a faster way and through the portal. This is the first step of the CEFTA, and basically it was successfully finalized around 2015, where following the adoption of the trade facilitation agreement in the WTO, we have taken over the second step of the CEFTA, which is still ongoing, and basically it's made of the trade facilitation agreement that was basically TFA plus, so WTO trade facilitation agreement plus, that entered into force in April 2018. The main tools of it are the implementation of the SEED and the SEED plus system for electronic exchange of data, and basically the customs in framework of the SEED, the customs data are exchanged between the parties. And basically, the parties are receiving pre-arrival notifications within the trade in CEFTA in the framework of this system. This system became quite known to everybody with the start of the pandemics. And basically, the system was used to establish the green lanes and the green corridors within the CEFTA that enabled the full supply of the foods, feeds, and medicines during the pandemics. And we all remember two years ago, how was the situation. This is one of the flagship tools that we are using, and it is expanding from the customs authority now to the with the SEED plus to the veterinary, phytosanitary, health authorities, all the authorities that are present in the BCP, CCP within the CEFTA parties. Another thing which is quite important is that basically last week we had a confirmation from Greece that they would accept the exchange of the data through SEED with Greece. That would be the first EU member state that would be connected to the systems and receive the information from the trade information in advance from the CEFTA parties. That was one thing. Second thing is the recognition agreements. So basically we noticed and decided that some of the tools that are functioning are not functioning very well. We had a lot of NTBs in the region. We had to do something to stimulate the traders further to trade in the region, and basically the full set of the recognition agreement was enclosed. Until now we have developed a decision on IAO's recognition. IAO is authorized economic operators, so basically the decision is adopted in 2019. The first three parties that were validated during the 2021 were Moldova, Serbia, and North Macedonia. And as well, we are working with a decision on recognition of certificates for fruits and vegetables in the recognition in SPS area, as well in the area of veterinary. As I mentioned today, we had the session on the harmonization of the veterinary certificates within the region. All of those issues that I'm mentioning are leading to the main goals of CEFTA, the elimination of non-tariff barriers, and basically harmonization with the EU legislation. As well, last year we followed the EU in the approach and adopted the transitional firm rules in June 2021. So following the rules of origin of the Pan-Euro-Med Convention. And as well, in 2019, we introduced in the trade in between the parties the full cumulation and the duty drawback in 2019, as I said. At the same time, parallel, which opens another huge portal of the activities that we are dealing in, that is the liberalization of trade in services. The agreement was reached between the parties in December 2019 and adopted on the Joint Committee in Tirana on the CEFTA week and entered into force in January 2021. The main things that the agreement is providing for is the deeper liberalization of trade in services than the one in the framework of the WTO, and of course inclusion of the non-parties to the WTO and parties of CEFTA to CEFTA liberalization of trade in services. In the framework of the raising number of non-resolved NTBs in the region, we have started the reform of the dispute settlement mechanism that it's undergoing and it's under negotiations at the moment. We are hoping that the negotiations would be completed until June this year. The issue was that in the framework of the CEFTA when it was signed, the dispute should be resolved through the joint committee decisions that are taken by consensus. So basically the party which would be guilty for some of the cases would not show up on the joint committee and you didn't have the ability to finalize the case. We are trying to resolve these issues and we are very close to finalize the negotiations. And by this, the CEFTA agreement, until we resolve this issue, will be the agreement without teeth, without the provisions that would force the parties to return to the inclusivity, to the framework of CEFTA if they are getting out. To return to services, the services agreement under the CEFTA has opened the door for several issues. One of the main is the e-commerce with the transposition of the eIDAS regulation in all of the parties. And basically the decision was prepared and sent to the party for the final approval towards the end of the next year. We are of the last year and we are waiting for the confirmation of the parties that the text is okay. As well, we started the work in the intellectual property rights and this is something which we will continue during the 2022, establishing the regional framework for intellectual property rights. Moreover, the implementation of the SAE 2020, Southeast European Strategy 2020, Regional Economic Area Mutual Multi-Annual Action Plan, and common regional market documents are the main activities that will be working in. We are working last 4 years and will be working in the next period. SE 2020 was the strategy that was developed in 2013 and was lasting until 2020. The Regional Economic Area Multi-Annual Action Plan was delivered in 2017 in the framework of the Berlin process of the accession, and CEFTA was leading the component dealing with trade, as well as in the SA 2020. And the Common Regional Market Document is the document that was adopted in November 2020 in Sofia on the Western Balkans EU summit of the Berlin process, and basically sets up the main guideline for the work in the next 4 years. It's covering mostly enhanced activities from the period that we were implementing from the 2013 to 2022. And it entails as well one of the very important for our today's topic, very important topic, and this is that everything which we are doing in CEFTA under the CRM activities is fully in line with the EU acquis. So basically the first one who of the parties who gets to the line that is implementing the legislation in accordance with the EU acquis, and then the procedures of the implementation of them, of those provisions are in line with the are in line with the EU procedures, is getting the benefits. That's why at the moment we have only three IAO validated parties out of seven, and basically the parties are slowly raising awareness and providing for more harmonization with the EU legislation and with the procedures. As well, there are two other things which we should mention. One is quite crucial, and it's covering the trade liberalization of trade in services, and one of the major bulk of the activities in the mobility area in the CRM, and this is recognition of professional qualifications. This is something where we as well have finalized the text of the decision of the recognition of the professional qualifications within the region. And basically at the moment we have to admit that we don't have the political capacities in order to make those decisions alive and starting to be operational due to some political issues that we are encountering within the CEFTA region. As well, I have to state that all of those activities, especially in the framework of common regional market, are heavily supported by the economic and investment plan of the EU Commission. That is based on the more relevant strategic documents, EA Strategy for Western Balkans, that was adopted in 2018, if I'm not wrong, new accession methodology that was agreed with the parties, and the EU trade policy document that was published in late 2020, if I'm not wrong, which all of those documents are saying a crucial sentence. When you fulfill the conditions in some areas that you are harmonized with the EU acquis and that you are basically following the procedures that the EU is following, you will be granted the access to the single market of the EU in those areas. This is something we need to see. We are trying to do it with the green lanes, basically, and we have the Greece, who will be the pilot project for so the border crossing between the Greece and North Macedonia. As well, what needs to be said, that the support for the implementation of this common regional market is provided by RCC, CEFTA, Transport Community Secretariat, and Western Balkan 6 Chamber Investment Forum, and that the period of implementation is 2021-2024. Basically, all of those measures which are listed in the last two slides, plus some other issues such as work permits elimination for the contractors and intra-company transfers, mutual recognition in the areas of quality infrastructure, and basically in the areas of the market surveillance, for example, the removal of the unsafe products from the markets, are the topics of the mutual recognition and are ongoing under the implementation and are implemented at this moment. What are the effects until now? I just pulled out three or four relevant essays on CEFTA, because usually the public awareness of the CEFTA issue is when something bad is happening. So basically nobody is saying, oh, we are trading and we have zero tariffs and it's great. It's not news. But basically when there is a problem, where there is a blockage, when there is a car stop, when there is a truck stopped on the BCP somewhere in the region or CCP, then immediately the CEFTA is mentioned as something which is completely useless, which cannot resolve the cases, and in similar issues. So I pulled out some of the good data. There is much more that I could pull out of the bad ones, but those are assessment and the analysis, and the other ones are the public, the articles in the press that are serving usually for a day or two, while the issue is actual. So basically, the recent Vienna Institute study from 2021 indicates that CEFTAs has made positive and significant effect of growth to the CEFTA parties. And as well, different studies are showing this positive impact on export of the CEFTA parties. So basically, Petrescu in 2018, that intra-regional trade grew by 74% to 127%, depending which party you're looking at. And Grivison in 21 finding increased export by 38%, but the export for smaller CEFTA parties are increased by 70%. And as well, as we are cooperating with other regional organizations, and we are focusing on bringing the tangible benefit to companies, we are using the parts of the RCC business barometer to question the businesses about the CEFTA. And basically, in the last one, 3 out of 5 companies in the region reported that they have benefited from the CEFTA, from the CEFTA activities, which is very good result. And basically, we come to the questions. First of all, we have the fears of the CEFTA parties on delays on the accession processes. And they are related mostly on the political level. And I think that this crisis at the moment is even deepening. This crisis with the Ukraine is even deepening this fear. The access on the EU single market, we will start to obtain it slowly. In accordance with those strategic documents, we have to see how those documents will be implemented in the practice. And the common regional market is often said that it's some kind of the new EFTA for the CEFTA parties, but not a way forward towards the European Union. From our side, as a CEFTA secretariat, we were created as a tool for speeding up and joining the European Union. Secondly, CEFTA and the regional cooperation is embodied in all of the SAA of the Western Balkan 6 parties. Thirdly, all the legislation and all the activities that we are doing it in accordance with EU legislation and with EU practices, which is more important. And we are heavily supported by the different EU DGs, relevant DGs, depending on which topic we are tackling. We have all the support of the European Union. And all of those issues are showing that CEFTA is going towards the European Union. The problems that we are facing at the moment are political from both sides, from the CEFTA parties and from the side of the EU, which has first tried to reorganize itself in order to be able to receive the new members. And from us, because due to our political situations in the region, basically we are progressing too slow in the harmonization of the legislation. And basically the companies which would be put now on the EU markets that are from the region would find it very hard to compete with the European companies. And what we are trying at the moment to make them through this common regional market is basically to prepare them and to give them a level playing field within the region in order to prepare them for the market competition that they would face by joining the European Union. So my answer to the main questions, yes, we are wearing the EU shoes. We are wearing more and more of the EU shoes. We are maybe missing the laces, but I saw several shoes that are going without the laces. And in any case, the regional integration in my personal, and I think of all here in the SEFTA, is not the or, but it's a tool to get to the EU accession, and that this regional integration is just the engine that fuels the EU accession that will happen in due period. So that would be it from my side. I'm open to all of kind of questions, and let me end this with a big thank you. And for detailed information as well, you can consult our Facebook, Twitter, and Facebook, Twitter, LinkedIn, and YouTube channels.
Thank you. Thank you, Amir. Thank you very much for this very, very detailed and extensive presentation. Just to follow the analogy, if the laces are missing, it's okay. If the soul is missing the heel, then we have a bit of a problem. So I think we will have the opportunity to discuss that also in relation to what you mentioned about the kind of more negative assessments of SEFTA that comes more in the media rather than academic research. But before that, or perhaps in anticipation of that, I will pass the floor to our discussant, Silvana Moisoska. Silvana, you're muted, I think.
Thank you, Vasilis. Thank you for the invitation. It was really interesting to hear Emir, no matter how many times I've been through all the documents that SEFTA are producing. I'm always astonished with a volume of the documents and the level that they are trying to achieve. So a lot has been done, Emir said, and he mentioned some of the challenges, but I would like to put SEFTA in a bit of broader perspective as we are connecting it to the EU. How actually the business community is looking at SEFTA, the data related to the trade shows that data that Emir presented from some of the academic studies indicate that there is an increase of the export and trade in the region. And that is true in absolute terms. And there has been some trade creation, but we have to be aware that the trade in the region has increased much more overall than the trade with SEFTA. So if we do some comparison, in before the COVID, as the COVID data are actually not really reliable, the trade was cut in many instances. So if we look at the pre-COVID data, 2018, compared to the data from 2010, we will see that there has been actually a decrease in absolute terms of the rate of intra-regional export and especially import. That shows that something has been happening with the region, and all the countries have been developing mostly due to the inflow of foreign direct investments, which actually are connected in these supply chains and value-added chains mostly with the European countries. So in this perspective, the region somehow didn't manage to connect these two processes. And SEFTA Secretariat and SEFTA countries, the parties have done tremendous work on all these things that Emir have listed. And these are important in order to make the trade organization, the trade structure happening. But we have to say that what was mentioned in the previous presentation has been mostly done or was going on in the past 7-8 years. Previously, in the period of 2006, when SEFTA was established up till 2010 or 11 or even 15, not many things were going on in terms of establishing the structure. It was notable from Emir's presentation that for all the issues in SEFTA, there is a necessity of agreement by all the parties. And that makes the structure very robust, and that makes the decision making very, very difficult. So having that in mind, I'm afraid I have to say that SEFTA has remained very much so in the political area of the countries, not in the policy ones. These documents that were mentioned are actually the documents that needs to provide a bridge between the politics and policies countries. So unfortunately, I would say that the countries, the parties were mostly focused on providing political will to sign something. And then when it comes to implementation on a policy level within the countries, there is a problem. And Emir is probably much more aware about these problems than anyone else, because many of them come to SEFTA and there is still not a functional mechanism about the dispute settlement and so on. So I'm pointing this out as SEFTA, by its nature, by its core, it's a very good idea. It should bring the region together, and there are some traditional links between the countries. In doing a deeper research about what countries actually do trade among themselves, the conclusion is that most of the countries are actually focused on traditional links that were there before actually destabilization and association agreements entered into force in most of the countries. So we could not talk about creation of new links. And here I will refer again to the necessity of this policy aspect of implementation of SEFTA. So all these documents could be done, but on the other side, we need to implement them. And the awareness of SEFTA should not be spread only to the public or to the business community, so they could shift their businesses to SEFTA or look for partners there, but also to be spread within the administrative structures in the countries in order for them to implement that. Lots of efforts has been put in to sign the additional protocol on trade facilitation. I followed SEFTA for a very long time, so I know some of the details, and really it was a huge achievement. But when you come to the practical trade, the companies would say, we have problem with sanitary and phytosanitary certificates. On every border, there is a custom servant or someone who has to implement that, and all of them are aware of the regulation. So that's one point. The other point that I would like to make is related to the parallel going on of two processes. The one is SEFTA, and the other one is the European integration of these countries. And there has been efforts to merge them. Actually, SEFTA from the start has been seen as effort to create kind of a single market in the region, or related only to free trade of goods and services. And then these countries to be able to join the EU, or as said with your words, to fit into the EU shoes. On the other hand, all the countries were going on with their national processes of European integration. And for many of them, due to the attractiveness of the EU market, and I must say, due to also to the benefits that this market is providing, as the countries are trading freely to the EU as well. And many of the businesses of the companies would say, when we trade with EU, it's much easier as we cross one border. When we trade in the region, we have to pay several borders. So all this indicates that these processes should be related in a very visible way, and that has been tried to be done with this common market that was mentioned into the presentation. But the common market is envisaged through four dimensions. The first one is most chances to succeed or to make certain progress, because there is a structure already and something could be done, and so the parties are working on that. The second one that is related to investment is a very difficult one. You cannot just make countries to create a regional investment policy and to perceive themselves as a region. So that is the main problem when it comes to CEFTA and also to any other regional initiatives. The will of the countries to perceive themselves as part of the region, as one region, needs to increase. Now, I must say that all these delays in the EU enlargement process and what's going on with, especially with North Macedonia and Albania, with all these delays due to different issues, is something that actually increases the awareness of the region that we are in this together. So that should be used by the region in order to create a joint, more stronger positions towards the European Union, as certain trade integration with the EU is already there. With CEFTA, the trade links as they were, there is some trade creation, and all this that CEFTA Secretariat is managing, all these additional protocols and what many other things that were mentioned by Emir, they should be delivered to the business community. As very often, but most of the companies in these countries are small and medium enterprises, and they don't fit to compete to the European market. They could more easily trade with their neighbors, with the CEFTA parties. But in order to achieve that, it is necessary to translate that and to provide very visible incentives to the business. CEFTA should serve the business. At the moment, CEFTA is still in some political framework, as many agreements needs to be signed. And the business community does not have a logic that would shift their business because of some agreement has been signed or promoted, but they would go where it's easy to do the business. So one of the good things related to the common markets and which already proved to be welcomed by the countries is the fourth dimension, the digital technologies. The roaming was eliminated in the countries, between these countries, and it creates a better platform for e-commerce. But in order to improve the e-commerce, we need special infrastructure for that. And I also didn't mention the infrastructure in the region. In order to create good conditions for trade, all the countries need to improve physical infrastructure and then the infrastructures for e-commerce. The initiative with green corridors, with seed, is excellent, but also what could be seen as maybe not an obstacle, but something that could delay the slow down the process is the different level of development of the custom systems in the region. So it's good to go with a pilot one. It's good to start. And I believe what is necessary to do now in CEFTA is to make priorities. Also, to some of the industries that are consist most of the trade among the parties are not a subject of specific treatment by the policymakers in these countries in order to promote the trade. So that could be improved, as well as the e-commerce is something that could be beneficial for especially for small and medium enterprises. And another thing related to the trade is that these small and medium enterprises, when they trade, they actually have a problem with the transport because they could not fill the full truck and so on. We have to have in mind that this is a very small region and these countries have small markets. So this was some of the practical issues that during the research I came upon. And I just wanted to make that contrast what CEFTA means in practical life of the business community in comparison to what it means on a political level, which was very well explained by Emir. And again, I have to acknowledge that a lot has been done and there are efforts to set a good ground for trade creation. But better connection between the politics and the policies relevant for trade in the region must be done in order to advance the process. Thank you.
Thank you, Silvana. Again, a lot of very, very interesting points. I don't know if Emir would like to, and how many of them he would like to respond to, but Emir, I will pass the floor to you. I think what was particularly interesting to me among the comments was this issue about the clarity and simplicity of the process and what it means to administrations, less of course the businesses. And we teach our students. I see some of my students are in the audience as well, so greetings to them. We teach our students about sort of effective policy change. One of the things that you say is that it has to have a kind of political simplicity and convenience, but also an administrative. So you have to have both, if you want the political elite, the political class supporting the reform or the policy process, but also you have to have the administration that they can find it simple, that they can understand it, they can implement it. So I don't want to single out this point in your response, Emir, but any points that you would like to respond to on Silvana's comments?
Well, I'm glad for the comments. I mean, yes, there should be a balance, and basically one thing which I would emphasize there is the internal coordination of the parties that are seeing the CEFTA processes, something which is on the side, and basically the EU process, which is the main thing, but while the two processes should go within the parties hand in hand. So basically something which is discussed on the CEFTA bodies should be followed by the parties through the SAA stability, through SAA committees and subcommittees, and vice versa. And this way we would have a double effect on the of the measures. Yes, we have too much politics in everywhere in the Western Balkans. When you touch, everything is related to politics and not policies. That's correct, but we have to change the mentality for that, and we are starting to do it bit a bit, but it's still always the politics who are taking over. Until this moment, related to the development of the exports, yes, and I'm glad that most of the exports are going to the EU. Then they're going to the CEFTA parties, because in the EU they get the people who are trading are getting the bigger prices than those that are offered on the EU market on the Western Balkan market. So it's normal that a company which can sell in Germany will sell in Germany, because it will get a better price than it will get it in the Western Balkans. But I hope that CEFTA has with the diagonal accumulation, and now with the introduction of the full accumulation, has contributed that the raw materials to those final products are coming from those countries, from the CEFTA parties. Sorry, this is something which basically is connecting tool of the so-called chains, that we have some small chains which are cooperating in between themselves due to the PEM convention and rules of and full accumulation of rule of origin are sending the final products towards the EU. And I'm more than glad that the export to the EU is raising more than the exports to the CEFTA. See, there's an example of digitalization as mentioned by Silvana, and the custom systems are quite well developed, and they are in all. I'm speaking about the IT systems now. They're quite well cooperating in the seed system since 2010, as it started, and 2015 the first implementation, and basically since then it's functioning very well. And the interest of the EU parties, EU and member states to join is not it's not negligible, especially now the with Greece, Italy is requesting to join the system. So basically, we have some benefits on it. And e-commerce, when somebody mentions e-commerce and says e-commerce is a very good tool, I immediately put my hats on, and I cannot imagine my colleagues who are dealing with e-commerce. So basically, we are speaking reforms in customs, reforms in postal services, reforms in the transport and handling of the returned goods, reforms in consumer protection. And did we finalize everything? Reforms of geoblocking, it's okay at the moment. But four or five significant reforms which needs to reform in the payment systems to reduce the costs. Otherwise, the product that you buy until it comes to you in a cross party trade would be costing less than the fees of transport and the conversion of the currencies. So all of those reforms have to be completed, and the parties are committed to complete all of those reforms until the 2024, and hopefully then we will be able to shop in the e-commerce as the people are shopping in the European Union. I don't know, this doesn't apply to the UK anymore, I'm sorry.
Yes, I was thinking we should get lessons for trade between Britain and Ireland and other places from CETA, but anyway, I won't raise the issue. We are ready to open up for questions and answers from the floor. There's a few questions already coming in. Please use the Q&A function for those of you that haven't asked your question, and please try to include your name and affiliation if possible. I will bring in a question by Howard Davis. I thought it was our former director, but it's Howard Davis from the European University Association. He asks, Emir, in particular on something you were saying in your presentation, if you can elaborate on the difficulties of implementing the recognition of professional qualifications. I think you mentioned also mainly political, but there may be also broader issues there. So if we can start with this as an example.
Thank you for the question. Yes, we are in the final stages. There were problems in the implementation since the long time. The if you remember well, the project was started in 2016 or 17 by a regional cooperation council, and not all of the parties have agreed to that. And the process was lasting till 2019. And in 2020, RCC and CEFTA have agreed to split the processes. And RCC is taking one part of the recognition of the architects, doctors, and I think there were four professions, and CEFTA is taking the general system of the professional qualifications. Both agreements are ready for the adoption and agreed. The problem is the elephant in the room, which we have at the moment, is basically that Serbia and Kosovo cannot agree on the terminology in the agreement. And from the technical point of view, both agreements are already negotiated. And the disagreement is related to some wordings and some denominations within the agreements.
Yeah, thanks. I think I'll bring in a question which is addressed to both speakers, so Silvana may also take the opportunity to say something. So Marlina Weismann from the University of Düsseldorf in Germany. See, thanks for the discussion and the presentation. And the question is that a lot of Western Balkan members suffer from political instability, a lot of government change, presidential changes, mentioned as example the case of Kosovo. This influences the strategic changes and delays the process. How difficult is the implementation of CEFTA trade goals within this difficult political climate? So more the sense of if you want, domestic policy cycle, political cycles than the interstate possible disputes, I would think. Do you think political instability internally is a factor that affects the functioning of certain blockers?
Political changes within the parties and the problems within the parties can be heavy impacting the agreement. Let's take Bosnia Herzegovina, where I'm coming from. For example, in the last seven months, I think we had the political problems where we didn't have a single session of the government. And basically you cannot adopt anything even if you want, so basically we are trying to avoid those kinds of the problems by doing the things on the technical level. So basically when you have them instead of the standing within the one of the party who can fulfill the conditions, we are trying to finalize all the discussions and the negotiations on the technical level and prepare technically the decisions that needs to be implemented and wait the political moment to adopt it. It as well relates, the same is the principle when you have the conflict within the two parties. Let's say when the Kosovo introduced the 100% in, I don't remember, 2019, I think. Yes, it was the beginning of, end of 2018, beginning of 2019. Basically, Serbia and Bosnia-Herzegovina didn't want to vote anything else until the 100% is off. And then with the political situation, we found a window of opportunity and we have prepared for three or four agreements that were adopted when we saw the window of opportunity somewhere in December when the mini Schengen started. We saw the window of opportunity and the acceptance of the two parties to accept documents. And basically, we used the opportunity to everything which was technically prepared push to the decision-making procedure and pass the decision-making procedure in the moment when the tensions between the parties or in one of the parties are slowly going down. So basically, this is the only way you can do it in the in an agreement which needs consensual decisions.
Silvana, something to add on this?
I would just add that it's very... Yeah, political instability contributes to instability in the other processes that are related to international agreements. And also it contributes to inconsistency in policy making, because when the country is in the process of elections or prior to the elections, then many things are stopped in the countries. And having in mind how many election cycles we had in this region, that means only urgent matters are dealt with, and that harms the process. And that's why, as I mentioned, now in the past 7-8 years, things are moving, and there is a big push also from SEFTA Secretariat. But the parties are those that need to make decisions, and the decisions are first made on a national ground, and then later they negotiate in SEFTA to reach agreement. And that's why definitely political instability delays the process, and it will. What Emir mentioned about e-commerce, I mentioned infrastructure, and he explained what infrastructure for e-commerce means. Having that in 2 years would be extremely difficult if we don't have sound political governments and political establishments in these countries in the next few years.
Thanks, Silvana. Before I take other questions from
if I may add,
of course,
to this, I don't know how much your Silvana interaction with the technical people. We have excellent technical people that are working in the ministries that are shaping up those decisions. And basically, at the political level, when it comes, none of the political parties which came anywhere in the region was doing anything against the EU integrations, or was not doing anything against the SEFTA integrations, which are basically the EU integrations on the smaller scale. So basically what you do here, you do it there as well. The problem is that the politics is stopping the reforms in some moments, as Silvana rightly mentioned it. So basically, the technical work and the technical people are working. And usually when we say administrations, we are thinking on everything in the package. I would like to divide the administrative part of the administrations, all seven of them, and the political level. Yes, political level is blocking, but the administrative part of it is working, and is working very hard and very well.
Okay, that sounds a positive assessment. Let me then bring in some other questions. I have a question that I will keep for later for myself. I want to bring a colleague, Eddie Gerber, who is asking how much of an appetite is there in the EU to expand the market, and especially, I guess, the Western European countries, or the old EU. I think that's his question. How much interest there is, how much urgency, I guess, there is. Is it about creating new opportunities or exploiting, sort of intensifying pre-existing links? And let me also link that to another question by Alina Weissman, who's asking if the European Union integration is made, if the European integration is made more difficult with the Serbia-Kosovo relations, but asking this also in the sense of how much appetite there is on the side of the EU. So Eddie's question is more on the economic appetite, and then I would think Alina's question I would turn into the political appetite for this.
Basically, economic appetite from the parties from the Western Balkan and from Moldova, appetite is there to do everything to join the EU. I think that mostly at the last period of time, there is no appetite from the EU, nor political, nor economical, to implement all of what is needed to assist the parties to come even closer. I mean, you see it where the two parties almost came into the final stages of the negotiations. We have changed the methodology and then basically returned them a step back. Now we have not only elections on the Western Balkans, we have a lot of elections in the EU, which are quite shaping and making the policy in the Western Balkans. You had the major change in the policies in the Germany. We are now with France in the pre-election campaign, which also might change the picture of Europe. And as well, you have a problem that the so-called old EU member states, as you call them, are basically resolving all kinds of the problems that they encountered with the new member states and the newest member states that are reflecting for the accession processes, be it from migration. And now, if you add the last months and the crisis which is happening around war in Ukraine, that's another something that should have been discussed today here, a couple of blocks away, between the EU Council and the US. And this is something which we don't know. We can find ourselves in the Balkans after 25 years of the accession process. 25 years of accession process. That sounds already sad. We could find ourselves that, let's say, Ukraine is going on the faster track, or I don't know, Moldova or Georgia. So for political, I cannot decide that this is something from two blocks away that the question should be addressed. But we feel it on the Balkans, the tiredness of the EU, political one. Economical one, it's there until we are a market of 20 millions.
Thanks. Amir, that links actually to the question, I think, then I will open it up to Silvana as well. But a question by Lukas Klimczak, if I can pronounce it correctly, from Krakow. And he's asking the question, do you think it would be advisable for Ukraine to join CEFTA? And Emil, of course, you said they may actually join the EU before before parts of the Western Balkans. But I mean, you know, also you can think different scenario, either of joining CEFTA, or as countries like Montenegro and prospectively Albania, North Macedonia leave CEFTA, then you have Moldova there, and then is naturally Ukraine to join. So I think, you know, of course, we cannot predict the immediate geopolitics of the war in Ukraine, but would it make sense for Ukraine to join CEFTA? Is it something that CEFTA can open up to, or is it too different kind of an endeavor altogether?
Question to me or to Silvana, I think, at this
point. Yes.
Okay, I will take this one. The geopolitics matters a lot, and now Ukraine, I hope this madness will stop soon, so we could talk about some rational solutions where Ukraine will join. EU is also not a fast track for Ukraine. It's not possible, no matter how it is promoted in the public. There is a process, and even if there is a willingness, political willingness by the EU, they need to fulfill certain criteria and so on. When it comes to CEFTA, it's interesting that Ukraine trades more with CEFTA parties than, for example, Moldova. So it's not something that we could not think of, but at the end, all these countries, they join these regional trade agreements in order to make some great trade creation. And that's possible if there is a structure of their industries and agricultural production that could be trade. This relates very much to the previous question about the appetite of the EU for this market. The trade integration has been going on for over 20 years between EU and the region. So the countries have their stabilization and association agreements, they could trade with EU. And if we look at the trade data, we would see that in their structure, EU is present with 70-80% of the trade. That means that the business is actually integrating at the extent that the political framework is allowing. In trade, in the area of trade, there are no tariffs. The companies have some problems with regards to fulfilling the standards that needs to be fulfilled on the EU market. But once they do that, they don't have problems anymore. So in that perspective, the economic integration, the trade integration is going on. Economic integration is lacking in terms of integration of these countries into these supply chains and into these value-added chains. And when I mentioned in my discussion that the region somehow omitted the chance to integrate better as a region or the countries individually in these supply chains, that is something that reflects the competitiveness of the region. So definitely there is a ground for further extension, I would say, of CEFTA, but we have to take into consideration that whoever joins CEFTA now, it is not a closed agreement, as far as my understanding is, needs to accept everything that was already accepted. So the country so far has put lots of efforts to come to certain conclusions. So that goes as a package. But however, it's not a very strange idea. So it hasn't been discussed heavily in academic circles, in political circles, but definitely yes. And it is also important that both parties, CEFTA and EU, are trying to build bridge between them. So in order to increase the integration between them, so yeah, if EFTA could be the way towards the European Union, there will be interest for other countries to join that.
Yeah, thanks, Ilona. Emir, I would like to hear also your view on this as well, and perhaps add that, of course, we have free trade agreements, you know, through European neighborhood policy with places like Ukraine. So, and of course, enlargement and neighborhood policy are now kind of under, you know, the same umbrella. But do you feel from the side of the EU, as CEPTA Secretariat, that there's a specific mandate, which is the pre-accession trade integration for the Western Balkans in particular, and everything else is out of reach? Because also, it's not only Ukraine, there's other places that the region could and should trade with, which also have the trade agreements with the EU, you know, from Tunisia and, you know, North Africa in general, and so forth. So do you get the sense that the CEFTA, so the Brussels view of CEFTA is that this is specifically for the Western Balkans and shouldn't be touched? Emil, we cannot hear you. I don't know if you're muted, but we
sorry. That was the view. The last things you said was the view of the EU in last, let's say, 2017, 18, 19. Why is Moldova there? For example, the view of the EU was different when the agreement was negotiated. I was a negotiator from the Bosnian side at the time, and basically we were chased to sign a free trade agreement with Moldova in speed, in order that Moldova can join CEFTA, because Romania in their accession negotiations wanted to have Moldova within CEFTA. And there were members of CEFTA for those 12 days. So basically that's how the Moldova came into CEFTA. And now it is completely detached. I agree that the trade is a problem, but it's steadily raising. We have to take into account that everything which needs to come from Moldova to Western Balkan has to fulfill all the EU standards, because Romania is a transit third party, let's say, for the CEFTA. So basically the problem is in the two-way in trade. So if you want to trade with Moldova, you have to fulfill all the technical standards of the EU, because you are transiting, especially in the agricultural and veterinary area, where Moldova is producing the most. But the trade is raising steadily towards the years. It's not raised from 100,000 to billions and billions, but from let's say tens of millions, now we are already at 60, 70 millions, which is a quite significant raise in the last period of time. The idea of having CEFTA expanded is how CEFTA 2006 started. It's basically the Visegrad came out in 2004, but at CEFTA in 2000, let's say, 6, when we came in, was Romania, Bulgaria, Croatia and North Macedonia, if I'm not wrong, with Bulgaria and Romania coming out in 2007. And basically, we joined all of our five in this CEFTA. What else could be done is would it include the near countries to CEFTA, or they would create a CEFTA for themselves there? This is a political geopolitical question which I cannot, especially from this position, which I cannot assess or say anything on that. The expansion of the agreement itself, I mean, it's not the trade which is the only issue, how would I say it, in the development and in the competitiveness of companies. Our task is to prepare the level playing field. It's not ours to, I don't know, change the labor laws or some kind of the legislations which maybe make some of the countries non-competitive for investment, and that they cannot join the value chains. Our task is to enable them, when they produce, to sell it easily, and basically to enable it to sell it on the time at the time that the buyer wants the goods. The rest is on the companies and on the parties themselves to make a field.
Yeah. Thanks. Let me take another two questions from the audience, which have been waiting for a long one. It's from Will Bartlett, a very close colleague, who is also part of this network, of course, and of LISI. You mentioned the economic and investment plan in the EU plan, which is, you were saying that the commodity market or CEFTA are in, you know, compliant or in support with this. So Will is asking, the plan is about, the 9 billion plan is about infrastructure investments, large transport and energy, basically. Is this type of investment supporting CEFTA deepening, or is there some other aspects of the plan that are relevant to CEFTA, or are there any relevant aspects of the plan that are directly relevant to CEFTA?
To make it short and blunt. If we make the BCP, CCPs disappear in the region, there is no use of it if you have bad roads. If you have excellent roads, there is no use of it if you are going to wait for 2 days on the border crossing. So that would be my answer.
Okay.
Everything is interconnected.
Very good, very good. Point taken. There's a question by Angela Mitanovic from Podgorica, a PhD student in Luxembourg, who is asking about Montenegro. She says Montenegro is a leader in negotiations with the EU. However, the Montenegrin public and political actors are divided over the question whether to join the new Open Balkan initiative or just focus on CEFTA and other existing processes and projects. If you were to advise Montenegro, would you say, what would you say? Should they join the Open Balkan and the Mini Schengen, or is it with better chances of becoming part of the Union if they join or if they don't join? So, what would be the advice to Montenegro?
Oh, I would be in conflict of interest for the position I'm doing. but basically, as the you said and everybody said, the initiative is good if all of the partners are in there. The initiative is good if they are following the EU standards, and the initiative is good. What was the third condition? I cannot remember now. It skipped out. But basically, the main two things are. It has to be all inclusive to reach maximum benefit to all of it, and it has to be in accordance with the European standards. Basically, at the moment, the initiative is not all inclusive, and I don't know what's going to happen and what's going to be the future of the initiative if it continues like this. You have at the moment an agreement that Montenegro is a part that is not in any way, how would I say, blocking the way of Montenegro towards the EU. It's just putting the wind into the sails. And I mean, I'm working for CEFTA. What to say? I mean, I would stick with CEFTA.
So there's also one technical question, and then we're going to close perhaps towards the end with more political questions. And I have to admit, I'm not very familiar with this, so I'll just read it out by Aida Nani. I'm told that the World Bank is proposing trade single window for individual countries, Albania, North Macedonia, and Serbia. As a contribution to regional integration, do you think that this is missing an opportunity to leapfrog straight to a regional trade single window similar to SEEDS?
I mean, I love the questions which have a part of the answer in there. Basically, yes, the single windows are something which the SEED would be the basis, the exchange of information which we are having and which we are upgrading thanks to the European Commission. The single window should be something which should upgrade it, but the seed plus, so upgrade from the customs to veterinary, phytosanitary, medical, was delayed for a couple of years. Some of the parties have signed a loan with the World Bank, namely the three parties which were set, and basically we are in close coordination with the World Bank projects in order not to duplicate the issue, but that they become the build-up on us And I have to say at the end that the European Commission gave the grant, not the loan, for the implementation of the Seed Plus. So basically, I hope I answered the question.
I think you did. I think you did. Silvana, would you like to add or to comment something on that? And also there's a question by Ivana Pritsa, again, a colleague, a member of the network, because you mentioned earlier that Ukraine trades more with CEFTA than Moldova. And she is asking, is this in sales or in absolute numbers? Because, of course,
now with when the things happened with Ukraine, for some of the countries that were affected, it really became an issue. North Macedonia has a free trade agreement with Ukraine, and it's much easier to trade with Ukraine than, let's say, to trade with Moldova due to the reasons that Emir mentioned. And for instance, 40% of the production of Macedonian agricultural producers of these early spring vegetables was going to the Ukraine market. So that has been lost now, and it's really a problem. So in that perspective, I said there are already trade links, and we don't do that with Moldova due to different reasons. So, and it's not always statistics. We were asked about the potential that Ukraine could join. There are already links, especially with the countries that Ukraine has free trade agreements, and it has with some of the CEFTA parties. With regards to this idea about single trade window, it's something that would definitely improve the trade in the region. It would speed up the processes, and these initiatives are not just welcome, but also necessary to be implemented as the real benefit for the business community is through implementation of such initiatives. So anything that could be seen on the ground as soon as possible is something that promotes CEFTA.
Thanks, Silvana. So a question that I was holding back, a question of my own, that again, for both of you. I mean, Silvana, you just mentioned that, you know, from North Macedonia, it's easier to trade with Ukraine because you have a free trade agreement than to trade with CEFTA. But then we're hearing all this time, you know, that CEFTA is the most comprehensive of free trade agreements and the most developed and advanced. Is there a sense that, you know, by trying to deepen too much too fast, given also the political problems, it makes it impossible for, you know, like, it's impossible to have clarity and stability, which is what a business would need. So, you know, maybe the trade barriers in trade with Ukraine are bigger, but they have been what they are for many years. Businesses that export to Ukraine know what they're doing, whereas with, you know, when they trade to, let's say, Bosnia, it's kind of a surprise every week, every month, what policy will change and what other thing will be, you know, added or shifted in some way. Is there a sense that then we're deepening too much too fast, making things overly complicated in trying to integrate fully?
I would say we have some unwritten rules under which we are functioning. So basically, any change in the legislation or the policy which is aligning the policy with the one of the EU is not a trade barrier. So basically, all of the parties are harmonizing their pieces of legislation on a daily basis with the EU. And we are considering this as the harmonization with the EU, and we are not considering as, let's say, a non-tariff barrier. Some businesses are considering, because when they come to the border and they say, okay, the legislation changed 2 days ago, they immediately scream, I could sell 2 days ago and I cannot sell now. But it's quite normal. This does not constitute a non-tariff barrier or such. Second thing, deepening the policies, not only deepening and widening the scope. I think it's much, much, much better for the whole framework of the harmonization, because we are not, let's say, 7 years ago, 6 or 5, when I came here, we were working with customs, SPS agriculture, technical barriers to trade. So with the people from exclusively one ministry, mostly in all of the parties, maybe in some of the parties, it's a bit different. Now we have a wide number of factors, which now gives the visibility to CEFTA. If you go to the services area, you have a bunch of sectors where you are entering, let's say education, in the framework of trade in services, health in the framework of seed plus. We enter much deeper into the veterinary and phytosanitary issues that we were dealing before. And it gives out the harmonization here. It's easier between us with the EU. And it gives out where are the missing papers which some of the parties didn't harmonize with the EU, and speeds them up to harmonize these pieces of legislation as well. So I think it's good because it's going wider towards the whole administration, and most of the people, let's say, in the Ministry of Education until we came with the professional qualifications and with the liberalization of education sector, were like, what the heck trade has to do with education? And it's same the ministries of health, the ministries of interior. What do we have to do with CEFTA, with trade? Yeah, but you are the last one of the border who is stamping the passport. Yeah, we need you.
Well, trade has to do with everything, indeed. Silvana, would you like to say something on this?
Yeah, I would just add that there are too many issues that needs to be harmonized in CEFTA. So. And the focus is on them, while the business is looking for the rational solutions and setting the better ground for doing the business. So I would say that all this focus on making things perfect on paper is actually increasing the opportunity costs for the businesses. And in that terms, what is missing in all this process is cost-benefit analysis. So everything, any initiative that is undertaken within CEFTA is not often, it's not supported by cost-benefit analysis. And very often the processes are prolonged for a very long time. So that actually keeps all the efforts in the background. It was mentioned in the first presentation that when CEFTA is doing something bad, then it is in the paper. So policy measures are in the paper when they are dealing with restriction. Not much has been done to deal with promotion of trade. So widening of the policies, as Emir said, and I fully agree, should be in perspective of building common or aligned trade policies related to the export and import structures of the countries. So definitely it's something that the whole thing needs to be in a way rationalized in order to be implementable in the more reasonable time framework.
Just a notion. Yep. I was not referring to policies that were wrong. I was referring to the cases when the truck is stopped on the border or something like this, that then you get the promotional benefit. The policies are not getting to the front pages of the newspapers.
Yeah. Okay, we're running out of time. I think we have only 45 seconds left. So it is, I think, the right time to ask the last question. And Emir, if you can answer it within 20 seconds, if possible. How can the problem of violation of CEFTA agreement by Kosovo in relation to Serbia be resolved? I think this is the 100% tariff, which, of course, has been...
It was removed, and hopefully with the adoption of the new AP7, we will have the possibility to resolve the cases faster.
Okay, so dispute settlement is going to be agreed. Can you give us a date for when it's going to be?
As soon as you give me the date when we will join the EU.
after 2025. Okay, well, we have to close here. Let me thank, on behalf of everybody, the audience and everybody in Lisi, actually, Emir and Silvana for the presentation and the discussion. We've been collaborating with SEFTA and with colleagues in the region on SEFTA matters, colleagues like Silvana, for a number of years now, and we very much enjoyed, you know, this interaction, and it was the first opportunity, quite strangely, to have Emir speaking at LSE. So I hope we'll have also another chance to do that again in the very near future. Before I close, let me just simply mention that we have another event. LSE Research in Southeast Europe have another event on Wednesday next week, 30th of March at 4 p.m. UK time, which is jointly hosted with the Hellenic Observatory of the LSE. The event is titled Weather in the Pandemic, the Emerging Financial Landscape in Southeast Europe. We have a big panel of very, very senior speakers from the European Investment Bank, the EBRD, the Bank of Croatia, the Eurobank in Greece, and elsewhere. So please join us if you can, 4 o'clock next Wednesday, 30th of March, 4 o'clock UTA time for our last event of the term. Emil Zikic, Silvana Mojsovska, thank you very much for your discussion and hope to see you soon.
Thank you, Vasilis, for the invitation. And we are open for any kind of questions which were not arrived at.